بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم أما بعد. All right, so last درس or last week we covered and we finished the discussion about Abu Talib and the difference of opinion with regards to Abu Talib. For those of you who were there, again, just a quick revision, and those of you who were not, we mentioned that both opinions do exist about Abu Talib. Yes, in the Sunni madhab, if you would, or school, that yes, there are two different opinions. I know, you know, a lot of people, you know, tend to believe that only Shias have this opinion about Abu Talib. However, a lot of Sunnis have this opinion about Abu Talib as well, as him being successful and going to Jannah, inshallah, and having been a believer and accepting Islam, etc. And we discussed both points. Okay. Now we get into his wife, Fatima bint Asad, radiallahu anha. So, al-Sahabiyya al-Sharifa al-Nasiba al-Hasiba al-Sayyida Fatima bint Asad, radiallahu anha. Hiya ibnatu ammi Abi Talib. She's the cousin of Abi Talib, right? So they obviously married within the family, married their cousin. So Abi Talib married his cousin, and obviously Fatima married her cousin. وكانت أول هاشمية تتزوج هاشميا ولم تتزوج من أحد غيره. So she never got married to anyone other than Abu Talib, and she was the first Hashimiyya to marry someone who was also a Hashimi. This had never happened before. كانت من السابقات بالإيمان والناهضات بالفضائل والإحسان أُمَّنْ حَنُونًا عَطُوفًا لِحَضْرَةِ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. She was one of the very first people to accept Islam. And she was extremely soft and caring and loving towards the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Very, very attached to him. فَكَانَتْ أُمَّهُ بَعْدَ أُمِّهِ. She was his mother after his mother. And as we're going to go over, you're going to see that subhanAllah, because of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's attachment to her, he didn't, you know, feel that he missed his mother so much or too much, because he had Fatima bint Asad as, you know, his mother in place of his mother. She and Abu Talib raised him. هي أخبر الناس بصدق النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم الذي خبرت أخلاقه وسلوكه. She's the one, you know, just like any mother, you know, knows their child better than anyone else. And Fatima bint Asad, she knew the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم better than anyone else. Anyone else. So she was the one who, you know, relayed to us a lot of his akhlaq and his mannerisms and things like that, etc. ولذا كانت الحادية عشر من السابقات الفائزات المستجيبات لله والرسول وكان إسلامها يوم أمر الله النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بإنذار عشيرته الأقربين. So when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was, you know, after he was given prophethood, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to start, you know, giving da'wah and calling people towards Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to start with his family or his close family. And she was one of them. So she was the 11th person in total, or in order actually, of those who had accepted Islam right away from the first da'wah, if you would, or the first, you know, calling towards Islam. إن مناقب هذه السيدة الجليلة أعز من أن تحصر بين هذه الأسطر. So Sheikh Khalid is saying here, he's saying, and he goes on a little bit, where he says, subhanAllah, he says, we're going to go over a few things with regards to her, but obviously, this is not our main focus in this book, number one. And number two, he says, sometimes when you want to speak of someone, No matter how much you speak of them, you can never do justice. You can never do justice. And she is one of those people. Radiallahu anha. وكان لها الشرف رواية عن النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. So she, even though obviously she was, you know, a lot older than the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as she was the one who raised him, etc. She did narrate several ahadith, approximately 40 or more, even in her old age, from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Now, just to show the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's love for her, listen to this hadith. An Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu قال لما ماتت فاطمة بنت أسد ابن هاشم أم علي. So Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says when Fatima passed away, and then he mentions Fatima, the mother of Ali. دخل عليها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم فجلس عند رأسها. So after she had passed away, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came to her body, and he stood at her head, at where her head was located. فقال, and then he said the following, رحمك الله يا أمي. He says, may Allah سبحانه وتعالى have mercy on you, O my mother. Again, remember several weeks ago we were talking about a hadith when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned my mother, or he said my father in Arabic. Like we explained, it's not necessarily the person's biological mother or father. Okay, and here's a perfect example as well. It says, رحمك الله يا أمي كنت أمي بعد أمي تجوعين وتشبعيني. He says, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on you, O my mother. You were my mother after my mother. You would go hungry and make sure that I was fed and I was full. وَتَعَرَيْنَا وَتَكْسُونَنِي. And you wouldn't have enough clothes to cover yourself, but you would give me clothes to cover me. وتمنعين نفسك طيب الطعام وتطعميني. You would refrain from taking of, you know, the good food, if you would, you know, when the good parts or good pieces of food, and give them to me. تريدين بذلك وجه الله والدار الآخرة. He says, and all you wanted from doing all of that was the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be successful in the hereafter. I mean, subhanAllah, but you, just imagine, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, saying these beautiful words to this woman. Imagine his love for her. Now we get to see it in the following hadith as well, to another extent as well. وَكَانَتْ وَفَاتُهَا فِي السَّنَةَ الرَّابِعَةِ مِنَ الْهِجْرَةِ النَّبَوِيَّةِ وَكُفِّنَتْ الْأُمَّ الْحَنُونَةِ بِقَمِيسِ خَيْرِ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ. So when she passed away in the fourth year of Hijrah. So after Hijrah to Medina, she passed away 4 years after that point. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam actually covered her or buried her in his thobe, in his clothes. So now this hadith that we're going to mention now is actually the continuation of the one we were just mentioning. ثم أمر أن تغسل ثلاثا وثلاثا. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered that she be washed. فلما بلغ الماء الذي فيه الكافور سكبه عليها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بيده. So when you know the time came to after washing, you know, her entire body, he wanted to take part in also washing her. So he took some water in his hands, in his blessed hands, alayhi salatu wasalam, and started, you know, washing her. ثم خلع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قميصه فألبسها إياه وكفنت فوقه. So like we said, he took off his jubba, put it over her clothes already that she was wearing, so that she be buried with something from him. ثم دعا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أسامة ابن زيد وأبا أيوب الأنصاري وعمر ابن الخطاب وغلاما يحفر فحفر قبرها. So then he asked, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Usama ibn Zayd, and then Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, and then Umar ibn al-Khattab, and then another Sahabi, whose name is not mentioned, but he says another Sahabi, another young man, to come help him sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam bury, dig up her grave. فحفروا قبرها فلما بلغوا اللحد حفره رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بيده. So in a grave, there's two ways that we can bury our dead, which is obviously, you know, straight, you dig straight down. But then there's another way which some people may have seen or heard of. I think it's more used in, you know, Muslim countries or Arab countries or whatever you want to call them, where it's kind of like an L shape. So you have, you know, the regular section which is dug up, and then you have a section towards the side. And this section towards the side is where the body is actually laid. And the body is laid in a way where the face, or the person is laid on their right side facing Qibla, and then behind them they'll, you know, they would put things like bricks or wood or things like that to kind of keep the body on its side, angled, facing the Qibla. And then basically when they put all the dirt back, it doesn't go or fall onto the body of the person. And it would just close up this section here, right? As opposed to, you know, this section here where the body would be. So he says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam started digging up this section here on the side where they were about to lay her in with his hands. He wouldn't use a shovel, he wouldn't use anything, and he started using his blessed hands, alayhi salatu wasalam. وأخرج ترابه بيده. And then he would take this dirt from that, and as he was digging out with his hands, and he would carry it so gently as if he was carrying an infant, a baby. فلما فرغ دخل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فاضطجع فيه وقال. After he was done, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself laid in the lahd, in this section on the side, laid inside of it, and he said, Allah, Allah alladhi yuhyi wa yumeet, Allah alladhi yuhyi wa yumeet, wa huwa hayyun la yamut. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives life and who gives death, and he is the forever living who never dies. اغفر لي أمي فاطمة بنت أسد. And then he made dua for her. He's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive her. ولقنها حجتها ووسع عليها مدخلها. And then he's making dua for her, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to, you know, enter her into paradise, etc. بحق نبيك والأنبياء الذين من قبلي فإنك أرحم الراحمين. And he says, you know, he made that dua, and at the end of that dua, he said, you know, by, you know, the honor, if you would, or by the right of your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam and all the prophets before me, before him alayhi salatu wasalam. And he says, oh Allah, you are the most forgiving, most compassionate. ثم كبر عليها أربعا ثم أدخلوها القبر هو والعباس وأبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنهم. So after this, obviously he came out. They laid her in her position. They prayed Salat al-Janaza on her, and then Al-Abbas and Abu Bakr helped the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam into her, put her into her resting place. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you can see from just these couple ahadith. Like I said, this is obviously not the focus of the book. Just to give an idea of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's love for this woman. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, named his daughter Fatima alayhi salam after her, after this woman Fatima bint Asad. He was extremely, extremely attached to her, and she was extremely attached to him. As we mentioned in our last dars, or even the one before as well, she used to be so attached to him that when he would come in, and he was a little infant, a little child, when he would come into their home, she would jump up and sometimes, start crying out of happiness and say, Ja'a ibnuna Muhammad al-Mubarak, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, our son Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the blessed one has come. And she would take him and she would hold him and she would kiss him and she would do everything for him. She would actually treat him, better than she would treat her own kids. Subhanallah. And almost all the time, if a parent does that, if a parent, shows preference to one child over the other, generally speaking, or like I said, almost all the time, the other children would become jealous. They would rebel, etc. But not in the case of this family, subhanAllah. We're going to cover a couple of their children today, but we're not going to finish it. But we're going to cover a couple of them, two or three of them. And as we go on, you guys will see this family. This family was just unbelievable, subhanAllah. Starting, like I said last week, from Abu Talib and Fatima bint Asad, they were just, a family like no other, subhanAllah. SubhanAllah, Fatima bint Asad, she used to not argue, but in like a playful way or a fun way with Abu Talib, saying Muhammadun yanamu fi hajri. It's like to argue with him, with Abu Talib, saying Muhammad's gonna sleep in my lap. He's not gonna sleep with you. He's gonna sleep with me, and he's gonna sleep in my lap, and whatever. So, subhanAllah, like we said last time, they used to wait for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam so that they can feed their kids, etc. And they were just, all over him, and they knew he was special. We saw with the ahadith about Abu Talib, what he did as well. So Fatima bint Asad, like I said, she was the 11th person to accept Islam, right? So she was, one of, the very first. And she obviously believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and supported him and treated him like no other, subhanAllah. So this is what I was saying, because he was treated so well from Fatima bint Asad radiallahu anha, he didn't have that feeling of missing his mother so much or too much, because he had that connection with a mother, which, like I said, she was the one who raised them, right? So she was there for him. So alhamdulillah, he didn't have that struggle. So now we get into their kids, and we'll go over the boys first. So we start off with Talib ibn Abi Talib. قيل إنه ابن الابن الأكبر من أبي طالب ولا يعرف عنه الكثير حتى ما يروى عن بعض حياته لا يثبت فيها شيء. So The first, if we want to be fair, like we said, because anytime there's a difference of opinion, we're going to show it, okay? We'll discuss our opinion and things like that, but we'll show all the opinions. So there's an opinion that their eldest son was Talib, okay? However, honestly, any hadith with regards to Talib, none of them are sahih, none of them at all. Actually, they're very da'if. And actually not, there isn't too much a hadith about him anyways. Okay? فَذَهَبَ الْبَعْضُ إِلَىٰ عَدَمْ وُجُودِهِ مُتَّبِعِينَ الْأَحَادِيثَ الَّتِي ذَكَرَتْ فِيهَا أَسْمَاءَ أبناء أبي طالب وفاطمة بنت أسد فلا نجد ذكرا لإسمه أبدا. If we go into history, and anybody who spoke about the children of Abi Talib and Fatima bint Asad, it's, you know, he's almost never mentioned, as if he's inexistent. Like we said, the only reason we're mentioning it is for the sake of, you know, mentioning all opinions. حتى الذهبي عندما ترجم لعقيل ابن أبي طالب قال هو أكبر إخوته. Even Imam al-Dhahabi رحمه الله, when he came to discuss or speak of the children of Abi Talib, he said عقيل, which is the next son we're going to be speaking about, was the eldest. So a lot of people just skipped over Talib because most people don't believe he actually existed. وذهب البعض الآخر قائلا إنه أحد الذين تاهوا في الأرض وكان محبا لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وله فيه مدائح وكان خرج إلى بدر كرها وذكروا له أشعارا وقال آخرون إن الجن خطفوه. So he's saying that some people made him Talib to be, you know, one of the pious people of the past, loving to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some people associated poems to him, to Talib again we're speaking of. And then some people said that that jinns had kidnapped him. So yeah. قال ابن الأثير في أسد الغابة وذكروا أن ثلاثة نفر ذهبوا على وجههم فهاموا فلم يجدوا ولم يسمع لهم بأثر. So this Imam Ibn al-Athir, he mentioned that there are three people three names which seem to be non-existent. They seem to be people who actually never existed. And one of them is Talib, the son of Abi Talib. وقال الإمام في أنساب الأشراف فولد أبي طالب طالبا وكان مضعوفا لا عقب له. So anybody who did mention his existence or spoke of his existence said that he never had any children. So you know, it's kind of a good way to, you know, to get out of, you know, the story. Bas khair, inshallah. Yeah, so basically that's with regards to Talib. If we want to be fair, like you said, we're just mentioning all opinions that are out there. You know, the majority is that he doesn't exist, okay? And the actual first son is Aqil. Aqil ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu. So Aqil, radiallahu anhu, was very much like his father, Abu Talib. in that he was a very fair person, very loving. He was very well respected, etc., and loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam very, very much as well. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه قال كان في قريش أربعة يتحاكم إليهم ويوقف عند قولهم. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said that there was four people in Quraysh who, when they would, so they used to refer to these four people with regards to everybody's lineage. They were the best with regards to people's lineage in history. And also when they used to say something, everybody used to listen. And he mentions Aqil ibn Abi Talib as being one of them. And then he mentions a couple more. Or three more, I should say. ولكن تأخر إسلامه فأعلن الشهادة في السنة الثامنة من الهجرة بعد حديبية. So actually, he had accepted Islam quite late. He accepted it 8 years after Hijrah, right? So after the whole time in Mecca, after they went to Medina, 8 years after that is when he accepted Islam. So after the passing of his mother, Fatima, radiallahu anha. وصلح إسلامه وكان من الثل القليل التي ثبتها الله مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يوم حنين. Again, when we were talking about Hunayn in the past, he was there. Aqil was there as well. And like we said, the only group of people who stood steadfast the day of Hunayn at the initial frightening, if you would, or shaking of the Muslims was only the people, or were only the people from the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one else. I don't care what Sahabi's name you give. No other Sahabi, unless they were a relative and close of the close family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every single one of them ran, except the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is just a fact, whether we like it or not, whether we want to admit it or not. This was a fact. This is what happened. And then, like I said, after that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he came back and started encouraging everybody and telling them, and riling them up again, and everybody came back. But at the beginning, when they got ambushed, everybody got frightened, they got scared, and they took cover and ran away, except the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Aqil being one of them, stood by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and did not dare leave him for a second. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam yuhibbuhum. An Abi Ishaq, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam qala li Aqil ibn Abi Talib, ya Aba Yazid. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Aqil, he called him Aba Yazid, or father of Yazid. Inni uhibbuka hubbayn. He says, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to me, he says, I love you two loves, two types of love. Hubban liqarabatika minni. One love because of your closeness to me. Wa hubban لَمَّا كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ مِنْ حُبِّ عَمِّي إِيَّكَ. He says, and the other love is because of how much I know my uncle, your father, right, Abi Talib, I know how much he loved you. So because he loved you so much, I love you even more. Because of, obviously, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's love for who? For his uncle, Abi Talib. And this just goes to show, we were talking last week about Abu Talib and the week before. Muslim or not. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly, and he said this to him after Aqil accepted Islam. Right? So Abu Talib, passed away a long time ago. And then he comes and he's still showing his love for Abi Talib, saying that I love you because Abi Talib loved you. Right? So like I said, Muslim or not, subhanAllah, that's just how a Muslim is supposed to be. You're supposed to be loyal. not just because the person is a Muslim, that we stay loyal to this person and we speak good of them. And if they're not Muslim, then we're like, nah, we got to stay away from them. Which doesn't make any sense, subhanAllah. You know, it's like, subhanAllah, you know, and a lot of the times, and we're going to get into this next week when we talk about Sayyidina Ali, alayhi salam, radiallahu anhu, as well. But, you know, I don't understand what it is with our community. But like I said, anybody who, you know, is not practicing, who's not Muslim, you know, we have a hard time speaking good of them after they pass because they weren't Muslim, which subhanAllah, that makes absolutely zero sense. But these things have nothing to do with anything. The person was a good person. They were a good person. You speak of the good that they did. Whether, I mean, look, there's so many Muslims who live terrible lives, unfortunately. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us all. They live terrible lives. And khalas, just because he's a Muslim, it's okay to talk about them and we want to forget about all the bad that they did. You know, that's all good and that, you know, fine and dandy. It's good to forget about, you know, the bad that people did, but not just for Muslims. So subhanAllah, I mean, this shows that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like I said, whether Abu Talib was Muslim or not, you know, he would, you know, speak of him in a nice and positive manner after his death, several years after his death. خوفه من الله سبحانه وتعالى. عن زيد بن أسلم قال جاء عقيل بمخيط فقال لامرأته خيتي بهذا ثيابك فسمع منادي ألا لا يغلن رجل إبرة فما فوقها فقال عقيل لها ما أرى إبرتك قد فاتتك. So now we're showing his level of what we call muraqaba, his level of consciousness, if you would, between his relationship with him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So once he found a needle, like a sewing needle, in the home of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. No, I'm sorry, forgive me. It was not in the home of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He found this needle. And he picked it up and he took it to his wife and he said to his wife, you know, please, you know, here, this is a needle I found, you know, you can use it to, you know, sew some clothes or fix clothes or whatever it is. And then he heard a call, if you would, you heard someone say, basically that a man, you know, can sometimes be misled by something as small as a needle. So as soon as he heard this, he said to his wife, he said, you know what? Forget it. Forget what I said. This has to go to Bayt al-Mal al-Muslimin. So basically it's, you know, Bayt al-Mal al-Muslimin was, as you guys know, was kind of like a, not necessarily just a bank account, but it was a reserve, if you would. It was a reserve of money, of food, of clothes, you name it. Home appliances, you know, for their time, subhanAllah. For anybody who was in need for these things. So right away he took it and he took it to Bayt al-Mal al-Muslimin, to that reserve for the needy. أكرمه الله سبحانه وتعالى بذرية صالحة كثيرة. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually blessed him with several pious children, alhamdulillah. 15 ذكرا, 15 sons, وسبعة إناثا, and then 7 girls. مات في زمن Muawiyah wadufina fil baqiyah radiallahu anhu. So he passed away in the time of the ruling of Muawiyah. So when Muawiyah was ruling, this is the time when Aqil had passed away radiallahu anhu. Now we get into another great Sahabi, Ja'far ibn Abi Talib al-Hashimi radiallahu anhu. So, علم المجاهدين أحد السابقين الأولين في الدين وكان أسن من سيدنا علي بعشر سنين رضي الله عنه. So سيدنا جعفر رضي الله عنه عليه السلام, he was one of the very 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 first Muslims from the beginning, and he was about 10 years older than Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. So first we had, like we said, Aqil, basically Aqil, and then after him was Ja'far, and then after Ja'far 10 years later was Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. من أهل المهاجرين الهجرتين إلى الحبشة والمدينة وكان المتحدث عند النجاشي عن المسلمين وكان إسلام النجاشي على يده. So Sayyidina Ja'far radiallahu anhu was one of the very few who took part in the hijratain, so the two hijras, one to Habasha, to Abyssinia, and then the one to Medina. So he was a part of the one to Habasha at the beginning, right? And he was actually the one who was sent to speak to An-Najashi, right? So the ruler in Abyssinia. And subhanAllah, the Islam, or the accepting of Islam of An-Najashi, was on his hands, Sayyidina Ja'far radiallahu anhu. وبعد الحبشة كانت هجرته إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في المدينة وكان صلى الله عليه وسلم يحاصر خيبر ففرح النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بقدومه فرحا عظيما وفتح الله خيبر على يده. When Ja'far came to the battle of Khaybar, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very excited and happy with his coming and his support. And with the help of Ja'far radiallahu anhu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the Muslims victory in Khaybar. اعتمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عمرة القضاء فدخل مكة وهو آخذ بزمام ناقة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال يومئذ لجعفر أشبهت خلقي وخلقي. Once the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Ja'far, he said to him, he says, you resemble me in my physical resemblance or appearance, and you resemble my akhlaq as well. So subhanAllah, he was like, you know, like we say, a copy paste of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, physically, and his manners and his akhlaq, everything, subhanAllah. You know, and it was very well known that Ja'far radiallahu anhu, like, really, really resembled the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where people used to, you know, be in awe with the beauty of Ja'far radiallahu anhu and always compare him to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had really blessed him with this, with that amazing gift and blessing. وقد بعثه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى مؤتة وجعله أميرا بعد زيد ابن حارث فقتل زيد. So once the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent Zayd radiallahu anhu and Ja'far to an expedition, and Zayd was killed. فأخذ الراية جعفر ابن أبي طالب فقطعت يمينه فأخذها بشماله فقطعت ثم قتل فوجد في جسده بضع وعشرون. سبحان الله. وقيل تسعون ضربة بسهم أو سيف أو رمح. So after Zayd was killed, Ja'far radiallahu anhu took the leadership, and it was a very common practice at the time where one the leader would be holding the flag. So when he was holding the flag, subhanAllah, you know, he got hit and his right arm was cut off. And then subhanAllah, with all his strength, having his arm being cut off and everything, he took it with his left until his left was cut off, and then he was killed, subhanAllah. And then it was said that about 80 to 90 different marks on his body were shown from either arrows or swords or anything that could have hit him in having killed him. So he really, subhanAllah, you know, was beaten very harshly. رضي الله عنه عليه السلام مقبلا غير مدبرا فعوضه الله عن يديه حنانين أو حنانين يطير بهما في الجنة فلهذا يقال له ذو الجناحين فعوضه الله عن يديه جناحين ويقال له الطيار. So subhanAllah, he was given, after that happened, you know, it was said that in place of his two arms, he was given wings. Subhanallah. And then after that is when he was given the nickname Dhul Janahain, the one or the basically the one with two wings. ويقال له الطيار ولذلك وقد شهد لذلك وقد شهد له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بالجنة والشهادة فرضي الله عنه. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is the one who obviously gave him these nicknames and said that he was given wings in place of his arms or his hands, and he was called الطيار, basically the flying one. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم obviously, you know, made it very clear to everybody that he was pleased with him and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was also very pleased with him. عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مر بجعفر الليلة في ملأ من الملائكة وهو مخضب الجناحين بالدم أبيض الفؤاد رضي الله عنه. SubhanAllah, once, so Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that one night, so basically he had seen Sayyidina Ja'far radiallahu anhu alayhi salam amongst the angels. He had seen him amongst the angels with those two wings. He had seen him with the angels flying with those two wings, subhanAllah. And subhanAllah, he said, on those wings were his blood that he gave for this deen and for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, but his heart was pure and white and clean. وَتَزَوَّجَ مِنَ الصَّحَابِيَّ الْجَلِيلَةِ أَسْمَاء بِنْتُ عُمَيْسِ. So he married Asma bint Umays, the daughter of Umays, radiallahu anha. And the children that they had, or that Ja'far had, was Abdullah and Aun and Muhammad wa Ni'ma radiallahu anhum ajma'in. So those were the children that Ja'far radiallahu anhu had. Now, we're going to, should I leave it for next week? Let me see if we can finish it next week or we're going to have to cut it. Yeah, subhanAllah. What's up? Someone had something to say? No? What's up? No? I heard someone unmute themselves. Yeah, inshallah. I think we'll start. We'll start it, inshallah. We'll start the subject of Sayyidina Ali, radiallahu anhu. It's a long subject, so we'll get it started, and definitely not gonna finish it today. But we'll get it started, inshallah. So, like we said, after Ja'far radiallahu anhu was Sayyidina Ali, and he was 10 years younger than Ja'far. سَمَّتْهُ أُمُّهُ أَسَدْ عَلَى إِسْمِ أَبِيهَا. Something that a lot of people may not know, maybe a lot of Sunnis won't know, probably the Shias know this, was that his mother, Fatima, radiallahu anha, actually named him Asad. She named him Asad, which means obviously lion. وكان أبو طالب غائبا فلما عاد سماه علي. So Abu Talib at the time was away. So when he came back, Abu Talib came back and he named him Ali, radiallahu anhu. أنشد في خيبر قائلا. So Sidna Ali radiallahu anhu, he said in Khaybar, in the Battle of Khaybar, he said, أنا الذي سمتني أمي حيدرة كليثي غابات كريه المنظرة. So he said in Khaybar, he says, I am the one who my mother named me Haydara. So yeah, we hear about Shia saying Haydar. So Haydara means lion, right? So he himself, you know, knew that his mother, Fatima radiallahu anha, named him Asad initially. And then his name was changed to Ali. And then he had a couple of nicknames being Abu al-Hasan. Okay? Abu al-Hasan. And also Aba Turab. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him the nickname of Aba Turab. So Abu al-Hasan obviously means, you know, the father of al-Hasan. And then he also gave him Aba Turab, which was basically means the father of earth, if you would, of like earth, like you know, the dirt, the earth, basically. ومناقبه تفر لها الكتب ولكن حسبي في هذا المقام الإشارة إلى بعضها. So Sheikh Ali is saying, he says, honestly, the virtues of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu alayhi salam were like no other. No other. You cannot find any Sahabi with as much virtues mentioned about them as much as Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, even in Sunni texts. Even in Sunni texts, you cannot find more ahadith about a Sahabi more than Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu wa alayhi salam. قال الإمام أحمد رحمه الله تعالى لم ينقل أحد من الصحابة ما نقل لعلي كرم الله وجهه. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal رحمه الله, he said that no Sahabi had as much narrated about them more than Ali كرم الله وجهه. هو أول الناس إسلاما بعد السيدة أم المؤمنين خديجة عليها السلام. So he was the first person after Sidna Khadija radiallahu anha to accept Islam. So the first person in entirety was Sidna Khadija radiallahu anha. After her was Sidna Ali radiallahu anhu. عن زيد ابن أرقم رضي الله عنه قال إن أول من أسلم مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم علي ابن أبي طالب كرم الله وجهه. This is Zayd ibn Arqam. He said that the first person to accept Islam after Khadija رضي الله عنها وسيدنا علي رضي الله عنه. وقد بين العلماء أن أبا بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه كان أول الرجال البالغين إسلاما، وعلي رضي الله عنه ابن أبي طالب تقدم إسلامه قبل البلوغ. So a lot of Sunni scholars, again, because of the whole political issues that we spoke about in the past, you know, they will try to do anything and everything to take away from whatever they can, try to take away from Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu and Ahl al-Bayt, unfortunately. But especially Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. So a lot of people came and started saying, oh, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was the first man to accept Islam. This is true. Because Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu was very young and he was a child, and he actually hadn't hit age of maturity yet. So he wasn't baligh yet when he accepted Islam. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was. In any case, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu accepted Islam before Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Not taking anything away from Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, but the facts are the facts. وقال أبو موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه إن عليا أول من أسلم مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Even Abu Musa al-Ash'ari رضي الله عنه, another one, he said سيدنا علي رضي الله عنه was the first to accept Islam after سيدنا خديجة رضي الله عنها. رباه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى صار من منزلة الأخ الأصغر. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, you know, raised سيدنا علي رضي الله عنه. And took him as his younger brother. And subhanAllah, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, took away the sons of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and in place, you know, gave him Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu to raise and to teach, etc. And as we said in the past, no one of the Sahaba was more knowledgeable than Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu and Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. Nobody was above them with regards to fiqh or ilm. Nobody. So subhanAllah, he was always like this with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Everywhere he went, he was with him. عن سعيد ابن المسيب رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم آخى بين أصحابه فبقي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبو بكر وعمر وعلي فآخى بين أبو بكر وعمر وقال لعلي أنت أخي وأنا أخوك رضي الله عنه. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on several occasions would basically declare, you know, to bring people together. He used to, you know, say that, look, you guys, like, for example, there was a few different or a couple different occasions where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did this, where he, for example, brought together the Muhajirin and the Ansar and said that you guys are like brothers, right? And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say something like that, obviously, you know, they would, you know, come closer and say and start treating each other that way, right? Because why? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them that they are like brothers to each other. So when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had done this amongst the Sahaba as well. So he said, he did the same thing between Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar. And then he said to Ali radiallahu anhu, he told him, he says, you to Ali radiallahu anhu are my brother and I am yours. So subhanAllah, you know, like I said, unfortunately, a lot of people want to try to take things away from Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. They want to try to deny some of his virtues, some of the ahadith about him, deny his status. And again, this all comes back to the whole, I mean, to put it straightforward, the whole Sunni Shia thing and the whole Nawasib and the Rawafid thing that we spoke about, which, you know, which is very sad and unfortunate. Like I said, we're going to, this is going to be covered in more in depth next week, inshallah. But basically, as I've mentioned in the past, and we're going to go over several ahadith about Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu and his virtues. But here are just a couple to kind of give you an introduction or a little appetizer with regards to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And these are all from Sunni sources. Again, all of these things that we're using or we're taking are from Sunni sources and no other. And they're all sahih ahadith. Either sahih or hasan at the very least. And subhanallah, I mean, the love that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had for Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, and vice versa, cannot be denied. Cannot be denied by anyone. And I swear to you, anybody who even, you know, tries to deny it, it's as if he's denying the, you know, the existence of the sun. You just can't deny these things. No matter how much you try, the facts are the facts. And whether you like it or not, this was the case. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had extreme, extreme love for Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. And the Ali radiallahu anhu had the same thing for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were very, very close and very attached to each other. عن سعيد ابن أبي وقاص رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لعلي كرم الله وجهه أنت مني بمنزلة هارون من موسى إلا أنه لا نبي بعدي. And this is subhanallah, this hadith that I just mentioned, which I'll translate it. He says the Prophet, so Sa'id ibn or Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, he says, you are to me like Harun alayhi salam is to Musa. So just like a brother. Illa annahu la nabiyya ba'di. He said the only difference is that there is no messenger after me. Whereas in the case of, you know, Musa alayhi salam and Harun, you know, one came after the other. He said, you are to me like Harun alayhi salam is to Musa alayhi salam, but that there's no prophet after me. This hadith is not only muttafaq alayhi, so in Bukhari and Muslim, it is mutawatir. Mutawatir. So like I've said to you guys before, even though a hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, doesn't necessarily mean that it's actually sahih or authentic 100%. But the ahadith which are mutawatir, that have the status or level of mutawatir, as we know, that is the pinnacle of siha, the pinnacle of strength. That there are no ahadith that could be stronger. Which means what? And what makes a hadith, again, just a quick reminder, what makes a hadith mutawatir is that everybody knew it. And everybody, what I mean everybody, I mean all of the Sahaba. So the masses, everybody knew that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this. وهذا واضح يدل على مكانته كرم الله وجهه من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فهو بمنزلة الأخ اللصيق في الدين والنسب رضي الله عنه. So Sheikh Khalid is saying that, you know, this hadith that we just mentioned about Sayyidina Harun and Sayyidina Musa عليه السلام, you know, clearly shows how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is attached to him, how close he is with him with regards to his actual relationship with him and his lineage or their lineage, right? So yes, they are cousins, but they were raised in the same home, right? They were raised in the same home and they grew up together. And as soon as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam became a prophet, he went back, Sayyidina Khadija radiallahu anha, she accepted Islam, and then Ali was right there, right from the start and never left his side for a second. And he was the one who was, you know, super, super close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, a lot, like I said, a lot of people, you know, try to play this game to take away things from Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. So, I mean, to be truthful and to be, you know, rightful, anybody who wants to talk about Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was the closest friend of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, you know, you'll always have a different relationship between your brother and your friend. It's going to be different, whether you like it or not. There's going to be things that, you know, you can talk about with your brother. You can show to your brother within your life, within your personal life. And there are, you know, sometimes some things that you would talk about with your friend that you wouldn't talk about with your brother, right? And I'm talking about, you know, the brothers you're actually close with, not the brothers that you don't actually talk to or don't want to talk to. So the brothers who you're very, very close with, subhanAllah, you know, you have that, you know, that tight relationship with them. And subhanAllah, actually, you know, in my case, you know, I have, you know, a relationship like that with my actual cousin. I have a cousin of mine who I'm very, very super close with. So subhanAllah, you know, I'm sure we can all relate to this type of relationship that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had with Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, but even to a stronger or higher level or scale. So we'll end there, inshallah. Like I said, I just wanted to give you guys a little bit of a taste tester of what we're going to be getting into with Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu. Honestly speaking, the hadith to come about Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, they're scary, man. They're scary. Subhanallah. What a man. What a man. And like I said, all sahih ahadith, which we'll get into and we'll cover next week, inshallah. But honestly, once you hear these ahadith, wallahi, I swear they blow your mind. They blow your mind. It's unbelievable. So subhanallah. Anyways, khair, inshallah. So we'll end it there for today. I don't want to keep you guys any longer. And we'll continue the subject next week. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Jazakallah khair, guys.